initially scored it for Jasna, but now they've corrected it.
Yes, I believe that did miss.
Okay, that ball tick the net and just missed the end of the table. And I guess one of the scorekeepers thought that it was good.
Just some beautiful backhand flat shots by Jasna.
We got a nice little turnaround here in the works. Jasna looking a little bit more confident.
Wow, some flat forehand there. Really changed the timing up.
I think Jasna surprised her with that deep backhand push. Ariel popped it up.
And it's 3-2. Okay, we've got a match here, Scott.
Well, it sure didn't look like this was going to happen when we were partway through game three there. But now, this was a solid win for Jasna this fourth game. Wait a minute, that was the fifth game, wasn't it? Right, so we're 3-2. The umpire scoreboard doesn't yet reflect that it's 3-2, but Jasna's just won the last two games, so she's on a roll.
Ariel's coach, I could see he was taking a lot of notes over there, and he's got his notepad out, so he's pointing to some of his notes right now.
Well, now Ariel's father takes a very statistical approach to this game, and he records a lot of details. He records like the number of pushes returned here or there, or successful smashes or loops to what side, and then he draws up a strategy near the end of each game based on those statistics, and then he tells Ariel what to do based on the statistics. It's a very scientific approach that we don't often see in this sport.
Yeah, I think that's good, you know, as long as he's not sending too much information to his player, a couple of key things for the player to think about. Wow, Ariel just really opened it up. Jasmine was hanging in there for a few shots, but...
First time we saw a very slight little frustration on Ariel's face when she missed that.
Oh, very good. Went to the backhand, then the forehand, then right back to the backhand.
Do you think Jasna's starting to pick up on Ariel's patterns of hitting to where he's better able to predict where Ariel's going with her next kill?
Yeah, it definitely appears that way. There's those flat hits you were talking about, Scott. That was a power loop by Jasna. We just had a pigeon fly through the arena here.
Ariel takes every towel break. Ty, you've played this this sport a long time, and it correct me if I'm wrong, but very often it's as the match goes on, you just start to develop an instinct for where your opponent's going to hit the ball.
Yes, both players will get, you know, grooved into what the other's going to do. And then it's a lot of calculations, you know, what you can get away with and what you can't get away with, and trying to figure out how to, you can just barely outscore the other player.
I believe Ariel gave a little apology for that. That ball may have just took the top of the net. I didn't see it, but I'm guessing that that's what happened.
Wow, just very strong shots, and not much Jasna could do on that.
Ariel was just one step ahead of Jasna at every swing that point, and Jasna just hanging in and hanging in, but Ariel put it away eventually.
Okay, it looks like Jasna has called a timeout. Go to her coach. I think she just felt that the tide was turning there, because she was up 5-3. Now she's down 6-5. So I think that was a smart timeout.
I agree. I think that was the perfect time to call timeout, because Ariel's game with those, like you said earlier, those high-risk, high-reward shots where she's just going for broke, well, that the ability to do that really depends on whether you're in the groove. And Ariel was clearly in the groove during those last 3 points. And I think one of the main reasons that the coach chose to take that timeout was to get Ariel out of that groove, to the hopes that Jasna could then come back and reassert herself.
That's exactly right, Scott, is just to break that rhythm, because when these young players get into a rhythm, it just can be devastating to the other player. So, yeah, that was the main reason, less for the what to do, but more of a break that rhythm.
We could see the coach trying to pump up Jasna, probably telling her the same thing. Well, I'll tell you, playing some of these kids, it's like playing a machine. They just never stop hitting the ball.
Yeah, they just play fearless. Yeah, Ariel just dictating the play there with Jasna, doing a lot of blocking.
Yeah, unfortunately for Jasna, Ariel came right back to the table and looked like she was still squarely in that groove. Seven to five, Ariel trying to wrap up this match.
Oh, just a devastating cross-court forehand by Ariel. I mean, just not much you can do.
I think those deep serves to the backhand is exactly what Ariel needs to do.
Yeah, that just puts a lot of pressure on Jasna, because Jasna has returned them nicely, but the third ball shot off of Ariel is just, she's just ready for it.
Particularly when Jasna's a little tight right now.
We're getting a runaway here. It's a match point. Ariel had won 7 points in a row there. And that's all she wrote. Ariel Hsing wins the second semifinals in the women's singles at the 2009 National Table Tennis Championships here in Las Vegas, Nevada. I'm with my partner, Scott Gordon, here.
And for the second year in a row, Ariel Hsing makes it to the final of the U.S. National Championship. At 14 years old, you would think, wow, that's really young to be in the national finals. But this is her second year in a row in that position, so she's already a veteran of the U.S. National Championship.
She certainly is. You know, that just shows the poise that some of these young players have. But, you know, she's been playing internationally, and so, you know, she's been playing for several years now, so this is not uncommon for her. So we're going to take a break here and prep things for our next match.